This is T-Tube English program. T-Tube is extending its programs in Ethiopian languages and upgrading its channel into media channel. Today we have come with the main issues on Tigray genocide, human rights violations, and humanitarian issues arising everywhere in the corner of the world. We are delivering our programs referring from recognized international references and attach evidences. T-Tube's aim is to transmit factual and seasonal information on Tigray genocide to the rest of the world and promote human rights. Subscribe our channel, comment, like, and share our programs. Thank you. Today, May 10, 2022, news headlines. Why do Western leaders support Ukraine but ignore Tigray's genocide? The Washington Examiner. What people from war-torn Tigray told us about the state of their lives amid the war. The Conversation. Ethiopia War, evidence of mass killing being burned, witnesses. By Lucy Kassa. Journalist, BBC. There's genocide in Tigray, but nobody's talking about it. The reasons range from internet shutdowns to just pure racism. By David Velazco, The Nation. Tigray government demands independent investigation after Major General dies in detention. France News 24. Wait with our detailed programs.
Property damage upon Ukraine. Why do Western leaders support Ukraine but ignore Tigray's genocide? American Examiner. May 9, 2022. By Michael Rubin.
On Sunday, First Lady Jill Biden became the latest Western official to travel to Ukraine and show her support for its people. The Ukrainian people deserve such attention. While the White House at first encouraged Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky to flee ahead of the Russian onslaught, the former comedian-turned-reformist leader stayed and showed himself to be truly Churchillian, in sharp contrast to those in Washington and Berlin.
Ukraine's resistance has come at a tremendous cost, although the price of liberty and freedom is always worth paying. The Russian war machine has inflicted tens of billions of dollars in property damage upon Ukraine.
Russian bombardment has killed thousands of Ukrainians and displaced millions. Russian forces summarily executed Ukrainian men, women, and children, often after inflicting brutal torture and sexual abuse. In Mariupol and elsewhere, Russia has engaged in a deliberate campaign of starvation.
That Russian President Vladimir Putin's megalomania, paranoia, and vengeance have taken a huge human toll is apparent.
There should be no moral equivalence. Castigating human rights abuses should be black and white. Unfortunately, a comparison of the genocide in Tigray shows that it is, but for the wrong reasons.
Ethiopian Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed is a zealot. African leaders and diplomats with whom he has met say he has a messiah complex.
While the Norwegian Nobel Committee once brought his reformist rhetoric at face value, it was naive.
Like Putin, Abiy's background is in intelligence and the secret police. While ascendant but before becoming prime minister, Abiy bragged to diplomatic visitors about the new technology that he had acquired to track dissidents.
The Tigray War erupted in November 2020 after Ethiopia's northern Tigray province defied Abiy's decree that it delay elections, ostensibly because of the coronavirus pandemic. Its defiance of the prime minister, while rooted in the law, led Abiy to accelerate his efforts to disenfranchise the region.
Abiy apologists say the Tigray People's Liberation Front started the fight when it attacked an Ethiopian army post.
But this is disingenuous. Ethiopia had already mobilized troops and prepared for a campaign against the defiant province's leadership before skirmishing erupted.
There are other parallels. As Putin sought to dehumanize his adversary and justify aggression by calling those in Ukraine's democratically elected government and its Jewish president Nazis, Abiy and his apologists suggest the Tigrayans with whom Abiy once worked in coalition were collectively guilty for past Ethiopian abuses. This is not to whitewash the TPLF. Successive Ethiopian governments have fallen short on human rights, but there is a difference between targeting those who abused their positions and an effort to punish collectively an entire province and ethnic group.
For more than a year before the start of the Ukraine conflict, though, this is what Abiy has done.
What Putin does to Mariupol, Abiy has sought to do to an entire province.
His famine threatens millions. Just as Putin counts on Western naivete to believe his promises of humanitarian corridors, Abiy allows an occasional United Nations convoy to feign cooperation, but he stops the trucks as soon as the cameras move on.
To President Joe Biden's credit, he has sought to raise the diplomatic profile of the Tigray crisis from his first weeks in office.
He has also appointed a succession of envoys, though no one has succeeded or, indeed, lasted more than a year. While the Tigrayan forces curtailed their own offensive to allow negotiations to occur, Abiy, like Putin, approached talks in bad faith. The war in Ukraine will shape freedom's future not only in Ukraine itself, but also perhaps in Russia and Eastern Europe.
The fight in Tigray will do the same not only in Ethiopia, but also in the broader Horn of Africa. It is time Tigrayans receive the same support, including high-profile visits, weaponry, and humanitarian assistance, that Ukrainians do.
That the West effectively ignores a slaughter on a scale greater than in Ukraine should cause introspection in every Western capital.
There's genocide in Tigray, but nobody's talking about it. The reasons range from internet shutdowns to just pure racism. By David Velazco, Thanatyayon. A humanitarian crisis is taking place in northern Ethiopia, but you may not have read about it in the news. In fact, you may have never heard of the Tigray National Regional State, which is currently encircled by Ethiopian and Eritrean forces. Those troops are setting up blockades, burning food silos, and going from village to village committing genocidal massacres and rapes. If we compare the situation in Tigray to other ongoing armed conflicts, the numbers are startling. Looking at civilian deaths, for example, the war in Ukraine has resulted in less than 3,000 Ukrainian deaths, according to the UN Human Rights Office, while Tigray has seen upward of 500,000, as per estimates by Ghent University. Ethiopian politics are complex. The nation has 5 parliamentary parties, 17 other national parties, and 15 other regional parties. In March 2020, Ethiopian Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed postponed the general elections set for August to 2021, citing the COVID-19 pandemic. The local Tigrayan government called this an unconstitutional attempt to extend his mandate and held local elections anyway. Abiy cut funding to the region, and the Tigray People's Liberation Front responded by attacking Federal Command headquarters in the Tigrayan capital of Mekelle, after which Ethiopian and Eritrean forces began their siege. But the violence is not merely political, it's also racial. There is long-standing conflict among Ethiopia's 3 main ethnic groups, Oromos, Amharas, and Tigrayans, as well as a desire among Eritreans to settle an old score with Tigray after decades of border conflict. The resulting ethnic tensions have led to violence that isn't limited to Tigray. Tigrayans across the country face attacks. Alim Lala Muhammad, a 21-year-old university student from Washington, D.C., told me that one of her family members was murdered in the capital of Addis Ababa in early April. He was a Tigrayan and, of course, as a Tigrayan during this time, you are a target. So all you can do is hide your identity or you will be killed. To be fair, some outlets, such as Al Jazeera, have provided ample coverage. But it is not enough, and it is dwarfed by the coverage of Ukraine or the Bosnian genocide before it. I don't know if the world really gives equal attention to black and white lives, who Director General Tedros Adhanom Ghebreyesus, himself an ethnic Tigrayan based in Geneva, said at a press conference given on April 13. I need to be blunt and honest that the world is not treating the human race the same way. Some are more equal than others. This is one of the longest and worst sieges of modern history, Tedros told me recently. There are 7 million people sealed off from the outside world for 18 months now. I haven't spoken to my relatives in Tigray in 18 months because telecoms are cut off. They are starving. But I can't send money because banks are closed. Current issue. War in Europe is startling to Western audiences, and it carries with it echoes of World War II and Nazi Germany, the horrors of the Holocaust, and the words never again. Tigray, meanwhile, is a foreign and unfamiliar land where discerning who the bad guys are can be difficult. Too often for US and European readers, the reaction to conflict in Africa or the Middle East is for many to shrug and say, isn't that region always at war anyway? Of course, another reason for the media's heavier focus on Ukraine is its geostrategic importance not only for Europe, but also, some would argue, Western liberal democracy. In Tigray, there is no threat of nuclear conflict or global economic repercussions, whereas Ukraine supplies 12% of the world's wheat and 17% of its corn. Finally, the Ethiopian government cut internet access in Tigray on November 4th, right before the fighting broke out, further contributing to our lack of knowledge about what's happening there. Tigray is far from the only region that has been cut off from the rest of the world in this way. According to a 2021 report by the digital civil rights group, Access Now, authorities cut internet access at least 182 times in 34 countries last year, including in 12 African countries. As in China, Russia, North Korea, and elsewhere, controlling internet access is a means of throttling democracy. But Tigray is in one of the worst situations in the world. The longest ongoing shutdown, in the federally administered tribal areas, FATA, of Pakistan, lasted 5.5 years, followed by less than 2 years in Myanmar's Rakhine State, and 1.5 years in Tigray. However, as Tedros noted, Tigray contains over 7 million people, while there are just 5 million in FATA and 3 million in Rakhine. Even just talking to refugees presents a challenge, since Google Translate, for example, doesn't feature Tigrinya, the official language of the region. Asmalash Tika, the Tigrayan creator of Lezen, language, an online translation service for Tigrinya, told me in English, it's been super difficult to share Tigrayan stories, because few people speak the language, but most importantly, Tigray has been sealed off, so the news that comes out of Tigray is from media outlets in Addis that are mouthpieces of the ruling party. It takes months until big media companies pick up news of massacres or rape and give them attention, if any at all. In addition, even dissident Tigrayans who live outside Ethiopia and speak foreign languages fluently are reluctant to speak up for fear of retaliation. Miaza Jebremedin, a Tigrayan activist who lives in D.C., told me she not only has a hard time getting anyone's attention but also avoids Ethiopian restaurants because of the potential danger from being recognized. I've been targeted both online and in real life, she said. In addition to the ever-increasing cyberbullying, a gun was pulled on me in L.A. last year while I was leading a peaceful protest by a self-proclaimed defender of the Ethiopian government. These intimidation tactics make it harder for Tigrayans to tell the world about the atrocities occurring in their homeland, such as the massacre of up to 800 civilians in the town of Aksum on November 28 and 29, 2020. The massacre barely made headlines in the West but has forever changed the lives of people like Gesh Lisenwerk, an engineer living in Addis Ababa. There are so many friends, surrounding people who grew up with us, killed the same day as my family, Gesh said. Gesh's father, Leek Lisenwerk, and brother, Binyam Lisenwerk, were barley farmers in Aksum. My father is the one who advocated for me my entire life, Gesh said. My father, brother, the husband of my older sister, my aunt's cousin and two other family members, Tekle Fitsum and Kybram Fitsum, were killed by Eritrean forces at our home compound. After the massacre, survivors from Aksum who knew Gesh's family visited him in Addis Ababa to tell him the news. Gesh said he became ill. It has been so hard to adapt to the reality that I lost my father, my brother, the husband of my sister, said Gesh. Every event and holiday I remember them, how they gestured, how they treated me. What repeatedly comes across from Tigrayans is the fear that their suffering means nothing and the hope, even as they remain cut off from the world, that someone is listening. Ethiopia War, Evidence of Mass Killing Being Burned Witnesses. By Lucy Kassa. Journalist. The remains of hundreds of people are being deliberately destroyed in an organized campaign to dispose of evidence of ethnic cleansing in the west of Ethiopia's Tigray region, according to interviews with 15 eyewitnesses. The allegations follow multiple reports of the targeting of the Tigrayan population during the civil war. They also come in advance of the possible deployment of a UN independent investigation team, which will be led by former International Criminal Court prosecutor Fatou Bensouda. People belonging to security forces from the neighboring Amhara region, which are occupying western Tigray, have been identified as digging up fresh mass graves, exhuming hundreds of bodies, burning them and then transporting what remains out of the region, the eyewitnesses said in telephone interviews. The authorities have acknowledged that graves have been dug up, but say that they show evidence that Tigrayan forces had been carrying out its own campaign of ethnically motivated killing in recent decades. Researchers from Gondar University have also been uncovering mass grave sites that they have linked to the Tigray People's Liberation Front, TPLF. All sides in the ongoing civil war have been accused of carrying out mass killings. But in a recent report, rights groups Amnesty International and Human Rights Watch accused Amhara officials and security forces of being behind a campaign of ethnic cleansing against Tigrayans in the area. The fighting, which began in November 2020, followed a dispute between Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed's federal government, and the TPLF, Tigray's dominant political party. Last December, the UN Human Rights Council passed a resolution to establish an independent investigation into atrocities committed by all warring parties in the conflict. The Ethiopian government objected to the resolution and vowed not to cooperate, saying the resolution was an instrument of political pressure. In a vote in March, Ethiopia's bid to block funding for the investigative panel failed. Russia and China had backed the Ethiopian government's attempt to block funding. Remains burned. Eyewitnesses have said that 3 days after the funding was approved, the campaign to destroy evidence of atrocities was launched in western Tigray. In the plot of land behind Hamali Hamish School in Humera town, 200 bodies of ethnic Tigrayan civilians were buried in two mass graves. These were civilians massacred in the early months of the war, said an eyewitness from the Welkiyata Think group who lives in Humera. Whereas Tigrayans either fled the area during the fighting or are in detention, members of the Welkiyat ethnic group remained and have provided the eyewitness reports. On April 4, the Amhara militias and the Fano, militia, youth group exhumed the remains. They gathered wood, sprayed something we never saw before and burned the remains they collected. The remains crumbled and turned into ash. This testimony was consistent with what other eyewitnesses said about the same incident. Amhara militia and Fano youth destroyed the remains of bodies buried in another part of Humera, witnesses have said. The bodies belonged to civilians who were paraded from detention camps. There were around 100 bodies buried en masse behind the land of the public office of the Humera Agricultural Institute, said another witness. They took the remains to the compound of the institute and turned them into ash using wood, fire, and chemicals that we don't know. As they were doing that, their faces were covered by masks and they wore gloves. Map. 1px transparent line. Ade Bay is another town in western Tigray where eyewitnesses have described the disposal of evidence by moving human remains. On the morning of April 10, the Amhara militias dug up the four mass graves in the St. Abune Argawi Church, a resident of Ade Bay said. There were 150 bodies of civilians killed in the August wave of ethnic cleansing. They loaded the bodies into a lorry. We don't know where they took the remains. Eyewitnesses said that on the same day, another mass grave, located behind the local government administrative office of Ade Bay, was dug up. 39 civilians had allegedly been buried there in October 2021 after being rounded up in the town of Adigashu and then caught trying to flee. According to the testimonies, the remains were loaded onto a lorry and moved to an unknown place. In another town, Beaker, which is located between Turkin and Royen, other eyewitnesses described similar activity. The bodies belonged to 70 civilians who had been arrested in Beaker. They were massacred 9 months ago, a resident said. On April 11, the Amhara militia exhumed them and took them to Sanja, a town in the Amhara region. Witnesses said the campaign of the disposal of evidence started on April 4 and was supervised by experts from Gondar University, which is in Amhara region. It all started following the visit of experts from Gondar University. When they came with trucks that were loaded with chemicals in white jerry cans. The experts were in the town for a few days giving training to the Amhara militia on how to dispose of the remains and then they returned, an eyewitness said. Three residents said that militia members had been publicly talking about the involvement of Gondar University and showing off about how the evidence of the killings would not be discovered. The university has not responded to a request for comment on the allegations. But last month, the state broadcaster reported that researchers from Gondar University had been working on 12 mass grave sites in the area and had found evidence that the TPLF had been involved in acts of genocide. Experts have confirmed that it is possible to dispose of human remains using certain chemicals. Andrea Sella, professor of inorganic chemistry at University College London, said cremation was possible as long as a high enough temperature was reached. Gebrekaden Gebrselassie, a doctor in chemical engineering at the RWTH Aachen University in Germany, also said it was possible to destroy forensic evidence with the help of chemicals that are readily available. These chemicals destroy the forensic evidence. But from a chemical point of view, even the ashes can show some evidence. It is difficult to destroy it all, he said. The Prime Minister's office has not responded to a request for comment. However, a senior Amhara official and the Speaker of the Federal Parliament, Ajegnehu Tezhager, denied the accusations that evidence was being systematically destroyed. He did say that exhumations were going on, but that the bodies that were being removed were those of ethnic Amharas who had been killed over the past 40 years. It was not possible to exhume the mass graves and show it to the world until these days because the TPLF was ruling the country, he said. The TPLF had been the dominant party in the coalition that governed Ethiopia from the 1990s until 2018, when Mr. Abiy came to power. Mr. Ajegnehu also rejected the reports of ethnic cleansing in Western Tigray, including those from Amnesty and Human Rights Watch. He described them as a lie. They are sensational reports which do not take into account the reality on the ground, he said. Famine in Ethiopia. The roots lie in Eritrea's long-running feud with Tigrayans. Published May 9, 2022. The Conversation. Academic rigor, journalistic flair. The war in northern Ethiopia that began in November 2020 has left millions in Tigray on the brink of famine. Reports suggest that nearly 40% of the region's 6 million inhabitants face an extreme lack of food. Shortages have forced aid workers to deliver medicines and other crucial supplies sometimes by foot. A few convoys have been allowed to enter Tigray, but the United Nations says convoys of at least 115 trucks are required daily. Yet the entire region is classified hard to reach. This indicates that it is effectively inaccessible. This is not the result of a natural disaster. It is a famine induced by the closure of the borders of Tigray by Ethiopian, Eritrean, and Somali forces, reinforced by militia from Ethiopia's Amhara and Afar ethnic groups. Since the Tigrayans' army retreated into their region in December 2021, they have been surrounded by armies that have blockaded Tigray. A handful of aid convoys have been allowed through. They have been far fewer than the humanitarian assistance required daily to feed the population. The blockade and resulting famine are well recognized. What is poorly understood are the origins of this crisis. They lie in a bitter feud between Eritrea's President Isaias Afwerki and Tigrayans that dates back to the 1970s, and the president's determination not to allow them to rebuild their forces by cutting their supply lines to Sudan. In a paper I wrote last year, I revisited this history, in particular the seminal moment in relations between the Eritrean and Tigrayan liberation movements. Lessons from the 1983-1985 famine. The Ethiopian famine of 1983-1985 was the result of a combination of a devastating drought and a ferocious war as Eritreans fought for their independence and Tigrayans for their rights. Both liberation movements used a lifeline through Sudan to provide aid to millions. They also brought in supplies essential for their war efforts. It is the memory of the utility of these supply lines that explains why the Eritrean, Ethiopian, and Somali alliance fought so hard to sever ties between Tigray and Sudan when the current conflict began in November 2020. Their aim was clear: to cut possible routes to Sudan, as well as meet the grievances of the Amhara community, who claimed that Western Tigray was part of its ancestral lands. Human Rights Watch reported that the attack on Hamera, at the tri-point of Sudan, Ethiopia, and Eritrea, began on November 9, 2020. Within 2 days, the town was in the hands of the invading forces. Tigrayan forces were forced northwards and eastwards. Tens of thousands of Tigrayan civilians were forcibly expelled. Afwerki's determination to crush the Tigrayans, who are, after all, the government of a region in a neighboring state, needs unraveling. The enmity between the Afwerki-led Eritrean People's Liberation Front, EPLF, now renamed the People's Front for Democracy and Justice, and the governing Tigray People's Liberation Front, TPLF, is long-standing, complex, and visceral. A toxic feud between rebel groups. Afwerki's loathing came about because of deep-seated differences over political strategy, which originated in student politics in Addis Ababa in the 1970s. But, perhaps above all else, there was the question of which liberation movement was the region's top dog. This feud festered over time, but came to the fore at the worst possible moment, the famine that struck Ethiopia and the Horn of Africa in 1983-1985. Their quarrel peaked just as huge quantities of aid were being trucked from Sudan into the remote areas of Eritrea and Tigray held by the respective liberation movements. Both rebel groups had established relief subsidiaries, the Eritrean Relief Association and the Relief Society of Tigray, to work with international humanitarian organizations to provide the resources needed to feed their people. They were remarkably successful. Some 750,000 tons of supplies, worth around $350 million at the time, were transported into rebel-held areas from Sudan before, during, and after the famine, from 1981 to 1991. The relief operation was not immune to divisions between the Eritrean and Tigrayan political organizations that had established them. In the mid-1980s, these divisions spilled over into an open dispute. There was a complete suspension of communication between the Eritrean and Tigrayan liberation fronts from 1985 to 1988. Afwerki, determined to show the Tigrayans that the Eritrean movement was the most powerful actor in the region, ordered his forces in 1985 to cut the road through territory they held and on which vital supplies from Sudan got into Tigray. Closing the border became etched on Tigrayan consciousness. Recalling the suffering the Eritreans inflicted, a Tigrayan leader declared, "I do not hesitate to categorize it a savage act. It must be recorded in history like that." Tekelwini Assefa, the head of the Relief Society of Tigray, made clear the bitterness he felt about the Eritrean front's decision. "They closed the road for about 2 years and we had no access to the Sudan for 1 month until we built a new road ourselves. And that was at the height of the famine." The Tigrayan movement was forced to march more than 100,000 Tigrayans across the difficult terrain of Western Tigray into Sudan, where they could receive international assistance. Many of those who made the journey were old, children, frail or ill. As many as 13,000 people are reported to have died along the way. Relations were eventually repaired, and the two movements went on to coordinate their offensives against the Ethiopian government. This culminated in the capture of their respective capitals in coordinated operations in 1991. The Eritrean Liberation Front was in power in Eritrea, while the Tigrayan Front led a coalition government in Ethiopia. But the rift never really healed. Rather, the wounds festered, leading to the disastrous Ethiopia-Eritrea border war of 1998-2000. It also underlies Afwerki's unwavering determination to destroy the Tigrayans as a political force. Unresolved tensions. In 2018, Afwerki welcomed the end of the Tigray-led government and the entry of Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed. Peace between Ethiopia and Eritrea was sealed in Saudi Arabia on September 16, 2018. However, Afwerki continued to plot against the Tigrayans. In his 2018 speech to the Eritrean nation, he declared that their loss of power had critical implications for the region and that the TPLF's toxic and malignant legacy needed to be removed. It was an attitude that contributed to the November 2020 war. But Afwerki knew from experience that winning that war required cutting the links between Tigray and Sudan. Western Tigray, linking the region and Sudan, remains the most deeply contested question and will be extraordinarily difficult to resolve. It is claimed by both the Tigrayan and Amhara people. Whoever holds Western Tigray holds the future of Tigray. This is the key lesson from the famine of 1983-85 and one reason it is such a complex question. As the crisis group put it, the future of Amhara-occupied Western Tigray is the thorniest issue to resolve.
There's genocide in Tigray, but nobody's talking about it. The reasons range from internet shutdowns to just pure racism. By David Velazco. The Nati Ion. A humanitarian crisis is taking place in northern Ethiopia, but you may not have read about it in the news. In fact, you may have never heard of the Tigray National Regional State, which is currently encircled by Ethiopian and Eritrean forces. Those troops are setting up blockades, burning food silos, and going from village to village committing genocidal massacres and rapes. If we compare the situation in Tigray to other ongoing armed conflicts, the numbers are startling. Looking at civilian deaths, for example, the war in Ukraine has resulted in less than 3,000 Ukrainian deaths, according to the UN Human Rights Office, while Tigray has seen upward of 500,000, as per estimates by Ghent University. Ethiopian politics are complex. The nation has 5 parliamentary parties, 17 other national parties, and 15 other regional parties. In March 2020, Ethiopian Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed postponed the general elections set for August to 2021, citing the COVID-19 pandemic. The local Tigrayan government called this an unconstitutional attempt to extend his mandate and held local elections anyway. Abiy cut funding to the region and the Tigray People's Liberation Front responded by attacking federal command headquarters in the Tigrayan capital of Mekelle, after which Ethiopian and Eritrean forces began their siege. But the violence is not merely political, it's also racial. There is long-standing conflict among Ethiopia's 3 main ethnic groups Oromos, Amharas and Tigrayans, as well as a desire among Eritreans to settle an old score with Tigray after decades of border conflict. The resulting ethnic tensions have led to violence that isn't limited to Tigray. Tigrayans across the country face attacks.
Alam Lala Muhammad, a 21-year-old university student from Washington, D.C., told me that one of her family members was murdered in the capital of Addis Ababa in early April. He was a Tigrayan and, of course, as a Tigrayan during this time, you are a target. So all you can do is hide your identity or you will be killed. To be fair, some outlets, such as Al Jazeera, have provided ample coverage. But it is not enough, and it is dwarfed by the coverage of Ukraine or the Bosnian genocide before it. I don't know if the world really gives equal attention to black and white lives, who Director General Tedros Adhanom Ghebreyesus, himself an ethnic Tigrayan based in Geneva, said at a press conference given on April 13.
I need to be blunt and honest that the world is not treating the human race the same way. Some are more equal than others.
This is one of the longest and worst sieges of modern history, Tedros told me recently.
There are 7 million people sealed off from the outside world for 18 months now.
I haven't spoken to my relatives in Tigray in 18 months because telecoms are cut off.
They are starving. But I can't send money because banks are closed.
Current issue. War in Europe is startling to Western audiences, and it carries with it echoes of World War II and Nazi Germany, the horrors of the Holocaust, and the words never again. Tigray, meanwhile, is a foreign and unfamiliar land where discerning who the bad guys are can be difficult.
Too often for US and European readers, the reaction to conflict in Africa or the Middle East is for many to shrug and say, isn't that region always at war anyway?
Of course, another reason for the media's heavier focus on Ukraine is its geostrategic importance not only for Europe, but also, some would argue, Western liberal democracy. In Tigray, there is no threat of nuclear conflict or global economic repercussions, whereas Ukraine supplies 12% of the world's wheat and 17% of its corn. Finally, the Ethiopian government cut internet access in Tigray on November 4, right before the fighting broke out, further contributing to our lack of knowledge about what's happening there.
Tigray is far from the only region that has been cut off from the rest of the world in this way.
According to a 2021 report by the digital civil rights group, Access Now, authorities cut internet access at least 182 times in 34 countries last year, including in 12 African countries. As in China, Russia, North Korea, and elsewhere, controlling internet access is a means of throttling democracy. But Tigray is in one of the worst situations in the world. The longest ongoing shutdown in the federally administered tribal areas, FATA, of Pakistan lasted 5.5 years, followed by less than 2 years in Myanmar's Rakhine State and 1.5 years in Tigray. However, as Tedros noted, Tigray contains over 7 million people, while there are just 5 million in FATA and 3 million in Rakhine.
Even just talking to refugees presents a challenge, since Google Translate, for example, doesn't feature Tigrinya, the official language of the region.
Asmalash Tika, the Tigrayan creator of Lezen language, an online translation service for Tigrinya, told me in English, "It's been super difficult to share Tigrayan stories because few people speak the language, but most importantly, Tigray has been sealed off, so the news that comes out of Tigray is from media outlets in Addis that are mouthpieces of the ruling party. It takes months until big media companies pick up news of massacres or rape and give them attention, if any at all." In addition, even dissident Tigrayans who live outside Ethiopia and speak foreign languages fluently are reluctant to speak up for fear of retaliation.
Niaza Jebremedin, a Tigrayan activist who lives in DC, told me she not only has a hard time getting anyone's attention but also avoids Ethiopian restaurants because of the potential danger from being recognized.
"I've been targeted both online and in real life," she said. In addition to the ever-increasing cyberbullying, a gun was pulled on me in LA last year while I was leading a peaceful protest by a self-proclaimed defender of the Ethiopian government. These intimidation tactics make it harder for Tigrayans to tell the world about the atrocities occurring in their homeland, such as the massacre of up to 800 civilians in the town of Aksum on November 28 and 29, 2020. The massacre barely made headlines in the West but has forever changed the lives of people like Gesh Lisenwerk, an engineer living in Addis Ababa.
"There are so many friends, surrounding people who grew up with us, killed the same day as my family," Gesh said. Gesh's father, Leek Lisenwerk, and brother, Binyam Lisenwerk, were barley farmers in Aksum. "My father is the one who advocated for me my entire life," Gesh said.
"My father, brother, the husband of my older sister, my aunt's cousin and two other family members, Tekle Fitsum and Kybram Fitsum, were killed by Eritrean forces at our home compound." After the massacre, survivors from Aksum who knew Gesh's family visited him in Addis Ababa to tell him the news.
Gesh said he became ill.
"It has been so hard to adapt to the reality that I lost my father, my brother, the husband of my sister," said Gesh. "Every event and holiday, I remember them, how they gestured, how they treated me. What repeatedly comes across from Tigrayans is the fear that their suffering means nothing and the hope, even as they remain cut off from the world, that someone is listening.
These were our today programs. Bye-bye for today.